Okay, so welcome to part three of my series on setting up my dual side-by-side imaging rig. It's taken quite a few weeks, if not months, to get to this point due to the weather, not being able to test things and everything, but I think I'm finally there. So for those of you who've seen part one, I sort of did my setting up the two telescopes on the mount and using the Primarosa Lab dual saddle. In part two, introduced the Optec Libra, which is the altitude adjustment plate here, so that I can actually align this telescope with this telescope, so that they're pointing at exactly the same position while imaging. And in this part three, I'm just going to run through how I've got Nina set up so that these two can image together. So it's going to be using the advanced sequencer, which I'm still pretty new to. And I'm also going to tell you about the synchronized dithering, which is going to be a must for allowing these two telescopes, or at least the two versions of Nina, which are running each scope, to talk to each other to make sure that a dither isn't occurring while one of the actual telescopes is still imaging. So look, it's a bit of a long video, quite a bit to get through, so let's get started. Okay, we'll get started looking into the software. Now it is a little complicated because we are dealing with two imaging rigs, and also we're dealing with the advanced sequencer, which I'm just learning myself. So no doubt over time, there'll be better ways of doing this, or there might be some better ways that people can suggest. Please leave comments below. But this is how I've got it set up at the moment. So since we have two imaging rigs, we need two instances of Nina. So I've got one running here, and here I've got another one over here. Just for those who aren't really sure about setting up a second instance of Nina, you just hit shift and then click, and then the second one will open up. So one of these is connected to the, is for running the Mead, and the other one is for running the Skywatcher. Now, one of them, when you're doing the synchronized dithering, one needs to be the leader and the other one needs to be the follower. And the leader is the one that's going to be controlling the mount and doing the guiding. The Mead in this instance will be the leader and the Skywatcher will be the follower. Now, there's a couple of things that you want to do before you get started, just to make life a little bit easier. And one is working out which equipment is attached to which telescope. Now, obviously, if you have different equipment, it's pretty easy to find up here, which attaches to which. So, for example, I have different focuses. So on the Mead, I have the Primarosa Lab robotic focuser, that's the one, attached. And on the Skywatcher over here, I have the Pegasus Astro focus controller. So that's pretty straightforward. The problem comes when you actually have the same equipment, exactly the same. So I've got the same camera. I've got the ASI 2600 MM Pro on both telescopes. And they also have the 2-inch filter wheels from ZWO. So it's good to be able to identify which is which. And I suggest that when you're starting this kind of thing, you know, maybe plug each one in individually and check which one you can connect to, and then you'll know which piece of equipment belongs to which telescope. And once you've done that, you can actually label them so that you know which is which when you're first connecting and opening up Nina. So for example, on the Mead here, if we go to the camera, it's got a fairly, you know, nondescript ASI camera one ASCOM there. But if you click into the settings, you'll see this box open up and you'll see I've got ZWO ASI 2600 MM Pro and I've got Mead written there. And what you do is on this little edit button, you click on that and this will come up and you can put a little tag in and you can apply that. And then from now on, you'll see the Mead there and you know that that is the correct camera that is attaching to the Mead telescope. I've done the same thing on the Skywatcher telescope and I just called it Sky W. When it comes to the filter wheel, and let's just go to the other rig for that. So here we are in the Skywatcher instance of Nina, and I've gone to the filter wheel. And again, you know, they both will say ZWO filter wheel, and you won't know which is which. Click under this little settings button, and you'll see a box that comes up, edit name. Click on that, just like I did with the camera, and put in your little tag. And I've put in Sky W for this one and Mead for the other. So definitely worth doing that so you know you're correct, connecting to the right equipment for each telescope. The other thing that's important to know is what images are coming from what telescope. so that you, what you don't want is, you say you're doing a target, I don't know, a M42, for example. You don't want both lots of images from both telescopes just all firing into an M42 folder, because then you have to work out which is which. So what I suggest you do is you go into the imaging tab, the options, and then your imaging tab. Now, we'll often have our images going into, or our targets going into an umbrella folder. And for mine, it's in my Dropbox and it's under a Nina folder. Within that, you'll find all your different target names. And so then you can go into there and deal with those images. But for this particular instance, I want to know which ones came from the SkyWatcher and which ones came from the Mead. So I've put here a little SkyWatcher at the beginning of this image file path pattern. And I've done the same on the other rig, but I've written Mead there. And I'll just show you what that looks like. Okay, so we just go down to my folder here. Now I'm in my Dropbox and under Nina, and as you can see, there's a whole lot of target names. But because I've added those extra names to the image file path, now I have a folder called Mead. And with it, that in that are my folders and my targets. And these are just some trial runs that I've done. And if we go further down, we can see the ones called SkyWatcher and exactly the same thing. So now I know what images are coming from which telescope. And that will just make life a lot easier when it comes to, you know, calibrating your images, etc. Right, so the next thing we need to do is we need to make sure that these two telescopes can work together. And what is needed for that is what's called synchronized dithering. Effectively, what that means is that, say, normally you dither every, three images, for example. Now, if you have two rigs imaging at the same time, if you have one that is the leader that is going to be doing the controlling them out and doing the dithering, if it comes to the end of that run of three images, it would normally go straight into a dither. The problem is if the other telescope, which is the follower, is actually still exposing an image, when it goes into the dither, that image will be ruined, and you effectively have to throw it away. What the synchronized dithering does is that the leader will finish its subs, and before it's about to go into the dither, and it will check with the other rig and see, are you finished exposing or are you still exposing? If it's still exposing, then the leader will go into a waiting mode. It'll just sit there and wait, and you'll see a little thing saying waiting. And when the follower has finally finished doing that exposure, then it will go in and do the dither. So that's how the synchronized dithering works. Now, what's required is a plugin for this, and therefore using the advanced sequencer. So if we go into plugins, and I'll just go down to all available, and right down the bottom, you'll see one that says synchronization. And in this area here, it said this plugin is intended for people who want to dither on a setup with multiple cameras on a single mount, which is exactly the setup. So then you just install it. And when you go and look at your list of installed plugins, you'll see synchronization there. And you have to do that on both mounts. So although only one is doing the dithering, both of them have to have the synchronization plugin installed. So let's go into the advanced sequencer. Now, the advanced sequencer, what I've learned all this from looking at Patriot Astro's YouTube videos. Definitely check that out. There's just a wealth of information there, everything you want to know about Nina. If something new comes out, usually Chad gets a video out pretty quickly explaining how to use it. So it's really, really good, and that's how I've been learning about this. And also what he's provided are all these very useful templates for different sort of ways you might be imaging, and he's done all the hard work and provided these for free, which is fantastic. So as you can see here, he's done things like a basic sequence start and a basic sequence end, and then there's one here called mono LRGB. So if you're going to do an LRGB target, you can use that as your template. If you've got offsets set up, then you do that, or a rotator. Same with the mono setups, and there's even some for one-shot color, and then there's some specialized ones if you're doing sort of exoplanet transits and, you know, making bias and dark frames. So I'll put a link in the description below, but yeah, have a look at that channel. A wealth of information and these really handy templates. And then once you've got these templates in and you've done your tweaks, you can then save them to suit your particular setup, which is great. So anyway, I've got a basic sequence start and a basic sequence end down here. And if we just look in here, we can see that there are some instructions to go through. What I might do is I might just quickly go to the one that's the leader, and we'll go into the sequencer here, because that's going to be connected to everything and it's going to be controlling the mount, controlling the guiding. So what we can see in this particular situation, I might just remove these readme files because they can just get a bit in the way. So what's happening here is your system is set at nautical dusk, for example. I mean, you can change this to whatever you like, astronomical dusk or a certain time or a sunset, and it'll work out what that time is. And it will unpark the scope, it'll set the tracking to sidereal, it'll cool the camera to minus 10, and it'll open the dome, or in my case, open the roof of the observatory. And then you can go on and start, you can include this, you don't have to. He's included what's called a safe sort of sync and autofocus. So what it's saying is that it will then slew to a sort of a safe area of the sky. So pretty much pointing close to straight up, not completely straight up, but and a bit away from the setting sun. And it'll switch the filter to luminance, which means that you'll pick up the most stars. And then you can run autofocus and you can solve and sync, and then the mount knows exactly where it is in the sky before it heads off to its target. Now, I probably won't be using this because I'm in the observatory situation and I tend to find that my rig goes pretty much straight to my target anyway. So I don't necessarily have to include that, but you can do. And then there's a bit of guidance here, which we'll remove. So that's basically it for the basic sequence start. And then on the basic sequence end down here, what it'll do is I've asked it to park my scope, because I want the scope to park to get out of the way of the roof. And then following that, it will warm the camera for take about 10 minutes to do that, and it'll close the roof. So that's how that's set up for the basic sequence end. Okay, so that's how it's set up for the leader. Now let's have a look and see how it is set up for the follower. Now over here, if I click on basic sequence start, you'll see some red sort of exclamation points here. Now, the good thing about Nina and the way it's set up with the advanced sequencer is this: if you don't have certain equipment connected, it will throw up this warning and say, hey, look, I can't carry out these instructions because the equipment required to carry out these instructions aren't connected. Now, in this instance of Nina, if you remember being the follower, it wasn't going to be connected to the mount and it wasn't going to be guiding. So obviously some of these instructions, such as unpark the scope, it can't do, and it can't set the tracking as well. So what I've been doing is I've been removing these. Open shutter dome, you can just remove that. And if you are using this bit about slowing to a safe area of the sky to sort of do your plate solving, etc., again, I remove the slewing one, just gonna make sure I get the right one, and also the solve and sync, because it's not gonna be doing that. Same with the basic sequence end. If I come down here, it's not going to be parking the scope. So I'm going to get rid of that. It's not going to be closing the dome. So I'm going to get rid of that. And it's just going to be warming the camera. And then what you can do is if you want to, you can save these as versions. So you could save it as basic startup follower and basic startup leader, and that way you can get your systems just immediately loading these in, ready to go. Okay, let's see how a sequence would work. Now I'm going to grab this one here, which I've called Rosette A Leader, and you can see we're already into nautical dusk. I'm actually not imaging tonight because it is overcast and cloudy, but just show you how the sequence works. So you can see here that the target is pretty low at this time, even though we're in a time when we could start imaging. I wouldn't start imaging now because the target's so low in the sky. I'd be actually pointing the telescope at the wall of the observatory. So you can make some adjustments in the sequence so that you can kick off at the right time. So here I've told, under my equipment check list of the sequence, I've said at nautical dusk, or actually nautical dusk is 9:40, but what I've said here is I've put an offset here of minus 10 minutes. So it's now 9:30 that this first bit kicks off. And what it's doing is just checking the equipment. It's saying unpark the scope if it's not already unparked, set the tracking to sidereal if that's not already happened, and cool the camera to minus 10. And that this 10 minutes just gives it that time for that to cool down if you haven't already cooled it. And then once you've hit nautical dusk, currently it's 10:09, so we've already gone past this, but I've got it here to say kick off at 9:40 and 35 seconds, which is calculated as nautical dusk where I live. But I've also put in here, also check that the target is above 25 degrees, because if it's not above 25 degrees, I'm just pointing the telescope at the observatory wall. Once those conditions are all met, it will go off, and I've told it to switch filter and go to the HA filter, because that's where I'm going to start imaging with. I haven't set up my filter offsets. If I did have my filter offsets run, I'd probably actually set this to luminance. It would slew in center on the target because a luminance center, it makes sense to use that one because it's going to pick up the most stars and make it easier to do plate solving, etc. And then it would kick off the guiding, and then it would run an autofocus. And of course, if I had my offsets done, once it moves to the first filter HA, the offsets tell the, you know, need a nose to tell the focuser which direction to move and how far for that particular filter. But I haven't got that set up so yet, but I do need to do that. So I have it on the HA filter, run an autofocus, and then it'll come down here, and if there's a filter change through these different filters, it will do an autofocus after that. If my HFR increases by 10%, do a refocus. Now, this is important, synchronized dithering. This is where the synchronized dithering needs to be, or at least this is where I found it's working, to put it in this part of the whole sequence. And it's set to do a synchronized dither every three images. And so every three images, it's got to check with the other telescope to make sure it's finished doing its exposure. I've told it to go through to keep, you know, running through doing these images till nautical dawn, and then it'll go into its basic end sequence. And here I've just set the smart exposures for it to do 20 of each filter, 5 minutes each, binning is one, and then here are the filters I'm doing. The dither you leave zero here, don't put in a number here, because the dithering is going to be done by the synchronized dithering, which is part of the triggers. So as it goes through and does an image, it's going to go and check these triggers and make sure if these triggers is met. So if we are about to change the filter, it'll go, okay, I need to do a new filter change. Or if I've reached three images, it will go into a synchronized dither. Now, on the follower, I've set up a sequence. So if I go into Rosette A here, what you can do is, so if you just grab that, if you're grabbing that same sequence, you can see there are all these things that I'm actually not doing, because this telescope is not connected to this instance of Nina is not connected to the mount. So it's not going to be doing meridian flips or center after drift. It's not going to attach to the guiding. It's not unparking the scope. So all these things I'm just going to get rid of, which it's actually not doing here. And which one? Make sure we get rid of the right ones. And it's not going to do the guiding at the end. And then what you can do is, once you've got this set up, so when you come back to this night after night, if this is the follower and you don't want to remove those all the time, just go up here and type in, say, follower. So it's a Rosette A follower. And then save it. And if we have a look here, you'll see that there is a Rosette A follower version here. So now I can just each night drag that across. And there's one other thing that we need to change with this. So it's going to wait. It's going to do the similar sort of thing at 21:30, so 10 minutes before nautical dusk. It's going to go through and check that I've got the camera cooled down, etc. And then with the sequence, we're going to have to adjust this, because if this telescope just starts straight off imaging, it's going to start doing either a focus run or its first image while the telescope is slewing to the target. Because you see, the other instance of Nina said at 2140 start doing the slewing and, you know, doing the plate solving, etc. So we need this to start a little bit later. So the best thing probably to do is just add in an offset here. And if I put 2 minutes, you know, you can check and see how long it takes for your system to do the slew and the centering. If it takes 3 minutes, put 3 in there. But if I click that there, you'll see this will change to 2142. And what that means is that as you go on through the nights, and as the nautical dusk time shifts, so, you know, in a few nights' time, this might be 21, nautical dusk might be 2143, this will always be, this will always kick off 2 minutes after the other telescope has started. So, yeah, make that change, and then, again, you can just sort of save it, save the whole thing. If I go up here and just do save, and it's just going to save it. And it will just run through similar things. It'll do go to the HA filter, it'll do an autofocus, etc. Now we've got the synchronized dithering here. As I said, we need it in both in the same place, and it needs to be the same number of exposures it's going to dither. And then it's just going to run through a very similar sequence on this telescope, on the Sky Watcher, until nautical dawn, and then it'll run into its basic end sequence, and all that's in here is for it to warm up the camera, because the other instance of Nina is taking control of the mountain, telling the roof when to close, and, you know, parking the scope, etc. So yeah, that's a very quick run through on how I've got a couple of sequences set up. So, and then each night I can just load them in, and yeah, hopefully the imaging will kick off smoothly. Okay, so we're coming up to a dither, because we're up at 4:56. You'll see this will hit 5 minutes, and one out of two clients waiting for synchronized dither. Now, if we whip back to this one, it's just finished its image and waiting for leader to dither. So this is how it works. So now if you look over here, see synchronized dither in progress, and we'll just wait for that to complete the dither. Please ignore the guiding. The guiding is terrible. I'm not sure why it's so bad. And it's back exposing again. We go back to this one, and this one's back exposing. So you can see how the leader here, it's just sort of waited for the other one to finish. So look, I hope you found that useful and interesting. It was a bit long, a bit complicated, but, you know, there was a lot to get through, as I said. There's a couple of things that I think need to be thought about when doing this kind of side-by-side system. The first was, can you get these two telescopes closer together? I think it does work a bit better if you can have them as close as possible. Now, I can't unfortunately move these saddles closer in, because the Losmandy plate here from Penalusa Lab is actually quite thin, and these don't sit high enough to get over these knobs. So I'm stuck with them sitting out here, but if perhaps you think about that, if you're setting up such a system, to make sure whatever plate you put in here will get these saddles high enough to clear whatever knobs you're using to seal it in, then you can actually move them and adjust how far apart they are. The second thing is the whole guide scope versus an off-axis guider. Now, normally when you are imaging, say with just one telescope, this one with the off-axis guider, in Nina there is the option to turn off guiding while you are imaging. And when you're using an OAG, that makes sense, because your guide star is going to go so far out of focus that guiding is going to start to go to hell. And that's probably might affect your focusing, etc. So it's better off if you have it set to turn off guiding while it does a focus. The problem with that is, if this one is still imaging, because this one is just refocusing perhaps because there's an HFR increase or whatever, if this one is still imaging, you're going to lose that image, because I've noticed that when the guiding turns off, the stars on this look terrible. So then it comes down to the whole point of, well, maybe you use an off-axis guider and you can carry on guiding, because your off-axis guider is not going to be affected by your telescope refocusing. One option may be that I might end up doing is attaching a guide scope in here,
and using that to do the guiding. And that way it doesn't matter what telescope is refocusing, that shouldn't affect the guiding. The guiding should be able to continue. And so if this is refocusing while this is imaging, I can still keep the image on this. So yeah, these are other things that I have to think about and work through, and I think it's definitely worth thinking about if you're setting up such a side-by-side system. And I'm sure as time goes on, I will find some more things that I need to tweak and adjust. But for the moment, I'm pretty happy with the results I've got. As I said, weather's been terrible. I haven't had a lot of time to image with this system, but I did do some imaging with the Rosette Nebula. And at the end of the video, I will show you the pictures or the images that I got from these two telescopes while they were imaging basically exactly the same time. So yeah, look, as I said, I hope you've enjoyed the video. Give us a like if you have, and consider subscribing to the channel. I'd like to thank everybody who has subscribed to the channel or watched the videos so far. It's been fantastic to see so many people leaving comments and yeah, just watching the videos and subscribing. Never really expected to get this number of people subscribing to my channel, but really appreciate it. So until next time, clear skies.